In this video, I'll demonstrate the basics of using SQLite in Python. SQLite 3 comes with any Python distribution, so you don't need to download anything extra. One of the biggest advantages of SQLite 3 is that it allows us to modify a database using SQL that doesn't require some third-party application server. First, open a new Python file and save it. Now import SQLite 3 and create a connection to the database file using sqlite3.connect. If the database file does not exist, one will be created automatically. Now create a cursor object, which will let us interact with the database. We can do this using .cursor on the connection object. With these three simple lines, you now have a connection to your database file and a cursor to execute queries with. Saving and running this script will generate our database. To execute a statement, we can use .execute on the cursor object. For example, if I want to create a table called names that has a key and one text field, I'd put the SQL creation query string as a parameter in the execute method. When this is run, the table will be created. To insert data, we can do something very similar to what we just did. Call execute passing a string of the insert query. In the string, instead of putting in values from an external source like user input or data from an API, put question marks. Now add a tuple as another argument to the execute statement with the variables that must be put in place of the question marks. This stops the risk of SQL injections and is better practice in general. If we save and run this file, we can now open a browser and go to a SQLite viewer. The link will be in the description and in the article for this video. Dragging the file into this allows us to look at the contents of the file. You'll see that the contents of the database has not changed. This is because we haven't committed our changes. When making a change to a database's data, it goes into a special state. You can see the data, but the data hasn't moved to the table yet. To save the data we just put in, we need to commit using connection.commit. Now when running, saving, and opening this file, we can see the row with ID 1. SQLite 3 supports auto-increment, which means that if the ID is not specified, it will be automatically increased. For this to occur, you must have used integer primary key, like I did when specifying ID. Now if you specify the column or columns to write to in the query while ignoring ID, it will be auto-incremented. Make sure to commit afterwards and then save and run. Drag the database file back into the viewer and you can now see that a value with an ID of 2 is in the table. Committing may seem like effort not needed, but it is very useful for applications that do things in transactions. When I say transactions, I mean write many things to a database for one event, but if one thing fails, they all need to be unwritten. A good example to show this would be to insert a new row into the table. Now if I roll back the database using connection.rollback, insert another row into the database and commit, it is expected that I'll only see the last row written. Save and run this file and then open it in the viewer. We can see that only the row with an ID of 4 was inserted, proving that the rollback worked. To get data from the database, you'll want to pass your select query to cursor.execute. Now we can use cursor.fetch1 to get the next row that has been queried for. In this example, I'll get the row with an ID of 1 from the names table. After getting cursor.fetch1, I can then get the ID and the name from the row using indexes. Although I obviously already know what the ID of the row is, I still get it from the row for the demonstration. If your selection query contains more than one row in the result, you can keep calling cursor.fetch1 to get the data. A while loop can easily achieve getting all the data, as cursor.fetch1 will be none when there are no more rows available. A better way to handle multiple rows as a result from a query would be to use cursor.fetchAll. This puts all the rows into a list object. Selecting all the names again, I can now use a for loop on the result of cursor.fetchAll. It may be an uncomfortable task to always use indexes to get data. Fortunately, Python provides a method to access row values using a key. Before you set your cursor, you need to set the connection's row factory value to sqlite3.row. Now when you get values, you'll be returned sqlite3.row objects instead of tuples. Going back to a simpler example, we can get the keys of a row using .keys. This shows that Python knows what the name of the columns in each row are. To use these keys, we can now use them instead of indexes, now that we are returned sqlite3.row objects. Looking at the output, no errors have occurred because those column names are in the row we queried. If you would like to look at a written tutorial and code for this video, head over to the article for this video in the description. Also, if you have any questions, put them in the comments and I'll try to help you with whatever you have issues with.